It started, I suppose, a few years ago with the film with Helen Mirren, and those are very sensitive microphones. And then, I so enjoyed writing those audience scenes that I then wrote a play based on those audience scenes, which Helen was also in. And of those scenes, the one I most enjoyed writing was the one between the young Elizabeth and Churchill, because it just felt so surprising and shocking to be writing about her as a young woman. And that relationship, you know, the young woman, the, you know, a very fragile and frail Churchill clinging on to power. I sort of thought, well, maybe there's a film in this. And I started tinkering with the idea, and then it just grew and evolved and grew and grew. Well, I mean, really just the story of a woman in whose lap this, you know, this bomb goes off, really. Her father dies much younger than anybody expected him to die. He died age 56. And suddenly she became queen at a very vulnerable age, when still in the infancy of her marriage. And all of us have been 25, I would have thought. There may be some people younger than 25, but, you know, to have this sort of responsibility age 25, and then for the marriage to figure that out, and then for the country to figure that out, and then within such a short space of time, two or three prime ministers in rapid succession resign, and, you know, what a handful, both as a woman, as a family, as a marriage, and as a country. And sort of the ripples stretch in so many different ways that I keep trying to figure out with Stephen what the show's actually about, because it's about all these things, and it's not just Elizabeth's story, it's also the story of who we all are in the second half of the 20th century at some level. We are sort of somewhere trapped in a no man's land between film and television, and I think that the way that technology is evolving, the way that viewing patterns are evolving, you know, it's really, having grown up on a sort of three television, then four television station system in the United Kingdom here, I still sort of pinch myself and try to understand. I'm behind it. My children are up to speed with what's going on. And I sort of keep, even though I'm working for Netflix, I keep asking my children what's going on with the television landscape. And they fill me in. You know, they're watching their films and their televisions in the same way. And people are drifting towards whole different modes of, you know, distribution and consumption. These have become like epic novels. I think in a very short space of time, if we were opening this, it's called a television show, but it must necessarily be something else, because it is, we made it in exactly the same way as I would make a film. There was nothing different about our process. I've made television and film for years and years and years, and this felt like a film all the time that we were making it. When Netflix first said that they were going to open this in, you know, in as many territories as they do on the same day, that was something that normally only happened to Star Wars, you know, or whatever, you know. And I'm still trying to process what this is, you know, this feels in many ways like a very, very British show, but it's an international show necessarily by virtue of the way in which it's being streamed and consumed and watched, or, you know, but I'm not writing it like that. I'm writing it just for half a dozen of us here, you know. I've got a lot of respect for what Julian Fellowes did and what Downton Abbey was and became. It was a colossal success, and we should be flattered to be considered in the same breath in that sense. But I suppose I'm just stupid, but we never gave Downton a single thought while we were making it. And I suppose we're all a bit surprised that we're being compared to Downton having made it. But I guess it's inevitable and flattered, I suppose, in that sense. I think like Jared said, we all thought we were making something quite different. You know, a story about the two most iconic houses in Britain, you know, Buckingham Palace and Downing Street. And that feels like, if you were to put us in a different time frame, the comparison with Downton would never happen. Mm-hmm. It's by virtue of the fact that we are roughly where we chronologically where I think they stopped. I haven't seen Downton, so I can't pass comment on it, but I'm obviously, as you, very aware of it. With regard to the way in which people are watching them, it's just a fact, you know, that's like getting into the Uber debate, you know, do we or don't we? You know, the fact is people are now traveling around London in a particular way, and prohibition never did anyone any good. And people are now watching television in this way, or film, or whatever we're calling it. And I'm certainly writing it, assuming that it's possible that people are watching 2 or 3 hours at a time. And so I'm mindful of how I'm composing the flow of a season. With regard to, is there too much time? I entirely agree with you, and I can't really imagine the idea of continuing. I'm utterly exhausted having written what I have written, and the thought of continuing fills me mainly with dread. It's an entirely all-consuming monogamy on a creative kind that I think is antithetical to the creative spirit. And I envy deeply and passionately all the other projects these people are flitting off to do, while I remain imprisoned in a gilded cage. So I have agreed with everybody concerned to really just wait and see what happens when the show comes out, and to give it some time, and to see how people are watching it, how it does or doesn't resonate, before even beginning the conversation of whether we need to go further.
In the meantime, and storyboarding episode 70.
in answer to your question about whether the canvas is too big, I mean, as far as I can see, the canvas is the second half of the British 20th century. It's a story of two houses and two lives. I think you could comfortably write 1,000 hours about this, because there are so many. What's happened is history necessarily reduces to a comfortable set of anecdotes. So the 60s become the perfumer scandal and the Beatles and whatever it is, you know, JFK's death. And it becomes like these pop reductive, you know, concoctions. And actually the great joy of this show is the extra space, so that you suddenly go into the spaces that have not yet been explored. And so for example, the great fog of London, which I suddenly thought, that's so damn interesting. I hadn't known about that, nor indeed the deaths that came as a result of that, nor indeed how the Queen was involved or Churchill was involved. And it's finding the things that we don't know that means that I don't think there is any amount of time that is too infinite to tell the story of who we all are and how we all live.